Hi everyone, welcome to our new tutorial at Sempiris Lab. My name is Adrian Correndo, I am a PhD candidate in agronomy at Kansas State University. Today, we are sharing a video corresponding to a recent workshop organized by the Agronomy Graduate Student Association at K-State. The specific topic relates to the implementation of regression trees and random forests in RAS software with prediction purposes. The first section contains theory and concepts I consider necessary before moving to the second part, which contains a live coding session. On the description of this video, you will find the link to download the necessary files, including the code and the dataset. Feel free to leave us any comments, suggestions, and questions you may have. Please subscribe to our channel to stay tuned with our latest material. Enjoy the video. And see you next time.
Our speaker today will be Adrian Correndo. I will be moderating questions through the day or through the afternoon. If you have questions while Adrian is speaking, I encourage you to put those in the chat. And if it is something that we need to stop and address that question real quick, we will. I'll bring it to his attention and we'll have a quick discussion. As was expressed in the original email leading up to these, if you have major issues, technical issues, unfortunately, those will not be able to be addressed in the moment. And so Adrian is gonna have a lot to talk about today, and so we won't have time to stop. I must express that unlike Carlos Pires, I am not of much help to you on that front, as I am not a substantial R user. But if a simple solution is available, then it would be offered. Otherwise, please follow along and enjoy the presentation. Remembering that this presentation is being recorded and will be made available, as will the complete code. So you will have plenty of opportunity to come back with it later after that technical issue has been resolved. With that, I'll hand it off to Adrian.
Okay. Thank you very much, Logan, for the introduction. And of course, thank you very much for all the attendance. It's a pleasure to, being able to share some of the models I've been working with during my PhD program. A big disclaimer before the beginning is that just be patient because, as well as you, I am a user. So I'm also learning. So we are on the same page, guys. So being that said, the outline of today it's to share with you a presentation, probably half an hour, 40 minutes, more or less. Where I'm planning to talk about the basic theory that I consider essential before jumping to the code. Is the theory that I had to read while learning, running, and trying with models with these algorithms. And thank you very much for the ASA for these workshops that I think that they are quite useful for all our students community. Okay, today's talk is about the tree-based model, decision tree-based models. Specifically, we're going to run the models in R, of course. So first of all, I would like to start with the definition of a decision tree. So a decision tree in the machine learning field is considered a learning method. It's considered probably one of the bricks of more complex models that we're going to address today. The main characteristic is that they are non-parametric. Non-parametric, it doesn't mean that they don't have any parameters. It means that we are not assuming this in a normal distribution or something like that on the residuals or the response variables, okay? So we don't require normality for while running these models. So that's why many times they are preferred over other techniques that are pretty flexible in this sense. And they belong to the family of supervised techniques. Yesterday, Leo was mainly sharing with you unsupervised techniques where we want to create clusters using different algorithms. But in this case, the main goal of these models is related to prediction. So we have prediction or classification. And by supervised, it means that we have a target variable that guide us during the learning process, right? So we have an observation or something that tell us which is the value that we want to obtain with our learning method. So you will see in the theory that they call it as labels, or the target labels. So that is the desired output, right? So if we want to predict, if we have a group of variables and we want to predict yield, our label or desired output is the observer yield on that situation, right? And based on that, we can establish an error, right? Depending on how accurate and precise are our estimations. That it could be related to classifying, so we may have misclassification rate, or they may be related to regression problems to estimate a numerical output. For those cases, we were going to estimate an error rate. And for example, in this case, it's very common to use the mean squared error or the root mean squared error and some alternatives. So these are the two most common cases, classification where we want to predict groups where the for the observations. So we want to know with other variables if our group belongs to the orange dots or to the green crosses, right? And then in a regression problem, the solution that we'll try to find is to predict as much as possible a process that is related to a quantitative problem, right? So that's how we can estimate an error comparing our model against the observed values. In this case, it could be the points. The main advantages of the tree-based model is that they are capable of handling both type of variables, continuous as well as categorical predictors. For example, as compared to PCA, the principal component analysis, the traditional version of the PCA cannot handle categorical variables. It's only possible to use numerical inputs. So in this case, this model presents an advantage. They are also very simple if we think on the tree structure, and they are very useful for interpretation purposes. Because they have this structure of a flowchart, right? Where the visual output imitates the human making decision process. So here we have a very simple case. Let me go with the... So this is a very simple case, right? Where our tree for deciding if we're going to take a job or not will depend on the salary as the most important factor. And then depending if it satisfies or not this minimum wage, we can, the second most important factor, it could be the how long is from, how far is from home, or also, I mean, if you are Brazilian, you maybe worry about how much coffee you have available. So that's the normal structure that we follow. So they are very intuitive to follow. So related to the disadvantages, The main problem that the decision trees have is a low prediction power. And I will show you a little more later. Although they are very good base learners, they are very sensitive to the training data set we use, okay? So imagine that the bound that the process that we want to make, if we are classifying or the limit is this line, but we are with our regression tree, what we are going to obtain is this kind of step by step, right? This is the structure of the predictions that we are is very common to observe with regression trees or classification. So they are very, they say, non-robust because they have a high variance. So depending on the training set you use to produce the learning process, the results that you are going to obtain, they might be very different. And we are going to see that in the example. That's why they say that the trees are very easy to overfit because they have high variance. So if we use a tree with many branches, we may read perfectly our data set, but we are not going to be able to predict very well unseen observations. That's the main goal when we want to predict, right? So for this reason, is very we encourage and it's very recommended to prune the trees, right? So the common structure of the trees, they are upside down because we normally see the root of the tree, and that is a common jargon on the regression and classification trees. We will always see the root at the top of the regression output. They say that they are recursive and binary split because what we are going to do is to divide the data in classes. So basically we are creating A versus B or greater than or lower than, always divided in two classes, okay? They are top down because it begins with a unique class that is the average of all the observations. So in this sense, they are very similar to perform an ANOVA. In fact, the classical regression tree performs an ANOVA. And what it does is so you have you have a null model where you only have the average of all the observations, right? And then you divide this whole population into subclasses depending on values of continuous or categorical feature. And that is what we call the root node, right? So where we have all the observations. And then when we start dividing the data into branches, we start to grow the tree. We say that they are greedy. You will find this also in literature because the splits are sequentially decided, right? And when we decide the split, there are some regression trees that allow us to estimate this, feature of future branches, but the regular regression and classification trees, they produce the best split at the level of producing a split. We are not considering what is going to happen next. So regarding to pruning, this is a very, I try to find an eloquent picture to show this. Imagine if we are pruning our tree, if we have an apple tree or whatever, we may want to have a good structure, right? So we don't want an ugly tree with too many branches all together, right?
So that's the main goal of regulating the size of the tree with pruning. We don't want to overfeed. And basically, we don't want to produce an infinite amount of branches. So we want to use the model that is good enough to produce good predictions, but no more complicated than that. The basic process of doing this is by constraining the number of the branches that we allow for our tree. We can also regulate those. So this is related to how many observations are needed to produce a new split. So imagine if we have, I don't know, 100 observations, and then we have one observation that is a very extreme value, and it also have a organic matter that is very high, and then we also have a high value, a high corresponding value of yield, but it seems to be an outlier because it's only one observation. So we don't want it to produce a split if we only have one observation with that behavior. So at least we want to have a minimum number of observations that they go to produce a new branch. And then we can also use some splitting rules, and that will be the difference between the different algorithms that we are going to see today. So related to this, the two main packages in our software to run the trees are R-Part, that they are the classical classification and regression trees. That's what the CRRT stands for. The guy who invented this is Leo Breiman. He's also the developer of the random forest models, which is very well known in the statistic field. And the regression trees are pretty old, are from the early 80s. And in R, the main package to do that is to do these models is R-Part. As an alternative, the main alternative, I would say, we have the PartyKit package and also the Party package, which is the old version, which is an optimization of the CART model, because it uses a different rule to produce the best split. So in order to produce a new branch, we follow a different criteria as compared to our part software. So these models are known as the conditional inference tree, because they call them conditionals because to produce, because of the splitting rules, because a new split, it will be depending if they satisfy or not condition based on a statistical criteria. And the main function to run this model is the C-tree function from this package. So what's the main difference between these models? The main difference in how the splits are produced, right? So in the case of R-Part, the classical regression trees, we use a parameter that is called the cost complexity parameter, the CP, that is basically tell us how much of the error we want to reduce if we produce a new split. So let's say that we want to produce a new branch. If this new division of our data set, it will reduce the error rate by at least 1%. So in that case, the CP will be equal to 0.01. In the case of PartyKit, the criteria is different because instead of considering the amount of error that we are reducing, it follows a statistical criteria. It's not a quantitative, and it follows a p-value. So when every time it's producing a new split, that new split should satisfy at least a significance. Is very similar to the concept of ANOVA, right? That we only consider an treatment effect significant if we at least have a probability of 5% of committing type 2 error, right? So this is the main difference. And we may see this as a great advantage. Let me show you next. And the parameter to prune the tree or to regulate the size of the tree here is alpha instead of the CP. So it follows the same names as a p-value. If you ask me my opinion about this, I would say that the R part package is much easier than the CP, than the C-tree to start with if we are new with regression trees, because it has some functions and the CP criteria to produce a split is very intuitive. So it's very easy to follow. It also allows us to use a cross-validation that is already included in the package. So it's very easy to run. And it's very useful to find the best CP value to produce, to prune the tree, right? So we're going to stop the tree when a new branch doesn't produce doesn't reduce a certain level of the error. The output is very handy. In this case, it already tells us how is the R square and how is the error and the cross validation error. In my case, I will say that it's very easy to fine tune the plots. As compared to the C-tree function, for which a new package has been developed, but I have no experience with this, so that will be your homework. At the same time, the main disadvantage of the R part that I see is that the splitting rule that it follows the CP, although it's very intuitive and easy to interpret. Many times it could be biased towards variables with more potential splits. Let's say that we have, temperature or that temperature is just ranging from, 15 to 20 Celsius degree. And then we also have precipitations, and precipitation is ranging from 0 to 1,000 millimeters. So it's very likely that these models will prefer precipitation over temperature, even though if the effect of temperature could be more significant than precipitation. And that is probably is not an issue for the tree itself, but it will be an issue if we want to produce a forest with those trees, right? So it will be an issue for the random forest that it follows the bagging process that I will explain later. In the case of the C-tree, my opinion is that it's for more advanced users. Once you get used to the R part, I will advise to move forward with the C-tree, but not before, because I think that we need to be familiar with how the algorithm works and so on. But the main advantages that it has is that they are following this criteria of the p-value, that it will produce less biased splits or branches as compared to our part. And that is very important if we wanna produce a forest. And that will be also one of the codes that we're going to run today. In terms of the trees, I will say that the default output is very ugly and it's very difficult to fine tune. We're going to see that later. Another problem is that they are depending on the options of pruning the tree. They can be computationally expensive, especially if we use one of the options that is doing a resampling technique with Monte Carlo. That is it's a very advanced option that I don't recommend. I didn't see any positive result of implementing this. Probably for some other cases it could be, but in my case, trying with several data sets, trying to predict yield, I didn't see an improvement of using these heavy options. And that's why they run very slowly. So now we are going to talk a little about the ensembles, the tree ensembles. So basically the tree ensembles are models that they are based on trees, but they are more complex because basically we are combining many trees. As well as the trees, they are also supervised because they depend on trees, non-parametric, and they can also handle categorical as well as continuous predictors. The main process for producing tree ensembles is bagging. Bagging means that we are producing trees over bootstrap samples. Bootstrap samples is a resampling technique where we take the original data set and we replace some of the observations So let's say that we have 500 observations, and then we take a sample, we feed a tree with 500 observations, but we don't use the 500, we replace a couple of the 500. Let's say that we replace 50. And then in another sample, we will also use 500 observations, but repeating, but also using 450 and 50, they are out of the model, but we are repeating some of the observation of the remaining of the 450, and that's depending on the number of bootstrap that we run. It will be the number of trees in our forest, right? So basically, with this technique, we don't prune the trees. We run trees of maximal depth. We don't put any constraint or restriction to the growth of the trees. So we just basically resample the data and run a new tree to each of those resamples. Okay, and then what we are going to obtain is an average of the prediction. So for each observation, let's say for observation number one, we are going to have one prediction for each of the bootstrap samples. So by the end of the day, what we are going to have as an output is the average or the median, we can tune that, of all those bootstrap trees, right? And that's why the predictions of the random forest are very smooth as compared to the classical trees. So basically we are going this, right? So we are going to resample the data, feed a tree to each of those subsets that they are combinations of the original data, but not always the same. And that's in the literature, they call majority voting in case of classification, or averaging in case of regression. And the main feature that the random forest is introducing to the bagging technique is that for every time we are going to decide a split, instead of taking all the variables, right, all the features that we have available as predictors, we just take a subset, a random subset of them. And that's how this process of random forest was very unique, because it allows to decorrelate the trees. We also have some more advanced technique, but it's also old, but nowadays literature is being much more explored than random forest and bagging, because they are more efficient. So instead of feeding trees to data that is resampled, bootstrap data, what we are going to feed is one regression tree or classification tree using, let's say that we have ill as our target variable, right? So we feed a small tree to our to predict ill, and then we're going to obtain residuals. So we're going to obtain error from the first tree. So in the second tree, instead of feeding a regression tree for ill, we're going to feed a tree to the residuals of the first tree, and so on. So the third tree will use the residual of the seconds, and that's how these kind of models, they are called as more efficient in the learning process as compared to random forest. And then you use different options, weighing the predictions or using learning rates, such as in neural networks and this kind of model, but they are very efficient for prediction. But today we're not going to cover them. We don't have enough time. So in terms of the algorithm, as I told you, random forest is a refined Bayesian technique that allows to correlate trees using a parameter that is called the M-trial, which is the number of variables that we want to randomly select before deciding a new branch of our trees in the forest. And the random forest uses the normal classification and regression trees, right? They are basically, it's an R part tree. And then the C forest, this option, use the conditional trees to build the forest. And that is also very important if we want to estimate the importance of the features for prediction. Because if we have correlated features, we may have some issues also with random forests. I will show you that later also. So although these two models may show a similar performance, the forests that they may produce, they will likely be very different in terms of the structure of the tree. And then we also have this example of boosting, and the most famous nowadays is probably the extreme gradient boosting. Which is a refined technique of the boosting method that I just explained in the last slide. So, related to the random forest, the main packages to run these kind of models are the random forest, who was developed by Leo Breiman in 2001. Then we have the conditional forest that they belong to the party or the party key package. And then you will also find some other options, and probably the most famous alternative is the Ranger package. That is very similar to random forest. In fact, it uses the same criteria, but it has some additional options related to probability attributes. We can fit quantiles of random forest or give a probability to use one variable if we want a priority or something. But we are not going to cover this. I just wanted to share that you also have this package available. These models, they have what we call hard parameters to do the tuning or the optimization process. They are mainly two. They are the number of trees that we want to build in our forest. Normally it could be 500, 1,000 trees. And then we also have the M-trial variable, which corresponds to the number of variables or the randomly selected variables that we're going to select as a subset to decide a split. Normally, it's not recommended to use more than 70% of the variables. Then the rule of thumb is It says that we should use about 30% of our variables as a subset or as an efficient subset to select the best split. And then we also have inside of the trees, we also have the parameters to tune that we're going to say in we're going to see during our regression trees part of the code. So a very important concept that we need to take care about while running this kind of models, where we are going to where we aim to predict an output, either a class or a continuous output, is related to the bias and variance trade-off. So for this for covering this issue, when we use what is known as cross-validation, right? Cross-validation is simply a data resampling technique, right? Without replacement. So we normally divide the data, but if we divide, let's say 50 and 50, we don't replace any data. So that is different from bootstrapping. That bootstrapping basically works if we have in our original data set 500 variables, each of the models that we are going to run, they will have 500 observations, sorry, no variables. We're going to have that amount of variables, but based on a proportion, not all the observations. We're going to repeat some observations in order to keep the same number of total observations, right? So the main goal of this is to of performing cross validation is to test the performance of our model on observations that are unseen. So observations that were not used during the training process. And this is very important. Traditionally, the most common way to split our data is use 50-50 or 70-30 or 80-20. And that proportion that we use as training and testing or training and validation sets, right? The main drawback of this approach is that it's very likely that we are going to be biased depending on what 50% goes to training and what 50% goes to validation, or what observations go to each of the subsets, right? So normally we want to repeat the process of cross-validation following different approaches. So the most important goal of cross-validation, as I told you, is to find an optimal level of complexity of our model. So we're going to fine-tune our hyperparameters, right? And we would like to accomplish, right, to achieve a certain level of complexity that is complex enough to produce good predictions, but it's not overfitting the model. So by overfitting, I mean that we are going to probably over-parameterize our model. So we're going to perfectly read our training set, but that model is going to predict bad on unseen observation, right? In the same way, if our model is less complex than ideal, we're going to underfit our model, meaning that it doesn't have the enough complexity to have good prediction, right? So here I just wanted to share with you the different options that we have for cross validations that I'm sharing in the code as well. The main option is known as the K-fold cross validation. So it's basically dividing it's doing that split of splitting of training and testing, but on different portion of the data. So let's say that in this case we have a K. So we have six folds, right? where we are going to try to separate the testing data, right? Trying to keep them always different, so they are not overlapped. Oh, sorry, I don't know what happened here with animations. As an extreme approach of the K-fold cross validation, we have the leave one out cross validation, where the K, the number of folds, is equal to the operations we have. So it will be equal to N, right? The main objective of using this model is to have a estimation of our model performance that is not biased, right? We use this type of validation, of cross validation, when our data set is mainly when it's too small, right? But the problem is that it may present that it might be very difficult or heavy to run. Another type of cross validation is, instead of leaving one observation out at a time, right? We have the leave one group out cross validation. In this case, let's say that we have a year of cropping season, right? And we want to set aside one cropping season at a time to see how the model is predicting that season when we use the rest of the season as training, right? So imagine that we have a cropping season such as 2012 here in the US, and we want to test how well our model it could predict that year using the rest of the year as a training data. The main problem that we may find with this is sometimes we don't have a balanced group, right? So the numbers of observations belonging to each group, it could be very different. And that could be a problem following this approach. And then one cross-validation that I like probably the most is called nested cross-validation, right? That is basically creating a K-fold, but we have an hidden and an outer loop. So we divide the outer loop or the whole data set into, let's say in this case, 20 folds, and then each of the 20 folds, it will be also divided into 10 folds. So in this case, at the inner level, we're going to optimize. So we're going to fine tune our parameters. And then this model that was training and validated or tested at the inner level, then once we have the best parameter for this, we're going to test using the whole set, right? We're going to see how it predicts the testing that it was never seen by this training set, right? So this is how this type of validation work, and it's getting more common in literature as well. So basically at the outer loop, we're going to obtain the generalization error, how well our model predicts unseen observations. So now I want to show you an example. I will go fast, and with this, I'm going to explain you briefly the variables that we have in our data set. So this is a publication that I published last year. This is a database of CORN, where we have more than 1,000 observations over the US and Canada. And basically, we were trying to predict grain yield or seed yield. In our data set, I just changed the yield values and also the features. And so basically the data set is a fake data set. So in this case, we are using weather variables such as precipitations. SDI means the Shannon Diversity Index, trying to reflect if the precipitation distribution is even or uneven. The abundance and well-distributed water, which is the product of precipitations and this diversity index. And we also include temperature related variables such as temperature, VPD, heat units, radiation, and the photothermal coefficient, which is Q in our data set. Then we also have soil variables that you will see in the data set, that they are soil organic matter and texture at the top soil. And we also have management variables that in our fake data set are tillage, fungicide, and inoculation, right? With this number of levels. So basically, we divided the weather into different periods using planting date as a reference. And then we have the pre-sowing period, and then we have the first, the second, the third, and the fourth month of the cropping season. The objective here for which we tested the random forest model was to address the predictability of yield and importance of soil, crop, and weather variables. So basically, these are the two main objectives that random forest used to be applied in literature. So in my case, for example, in my paper, I tested and compared different prediction frameworks considering no weather or including weather during the spring or the whole season weather. And in my case, I used a C-forest model for the reason of producing unbiased splits on the trees across the forest. That's the reason behind my decision. And also because we also able to apply a conditional permutation importance that we're going to see later on the code. And then we have tested the performance of the model following different methods, like the room mean square error or bias R square, etc. So this is our result, for example, for predicting maize yield with random forest following the different frameworks, no weather or using spring weather or full weather. So this was a kind of sensitivity analysis. And we also produced an output related to the importance of the different features for the prediction of yield. So in our case, it turns out that for predicting maize yield, the most important variable was previous crop, for example, and also irrigation. In terms of soil organic matter, was the most important. And then the related weather variables, we were also able to establish a ranking of the variables. Comparing models, here I have the comparison of three models. The random forest in the the random forest in orange, the conditional forest in green, and the boosting in blue. So basically, what we observe is that the performance of the model was better on the boosting, using the boosting approach, and it was similar, probably a little worse using the C-forest, but it allowed a better estimation of the importance of the variables. But the problem that the random forests are not able to solve is this tail. If you see, we have a tail of over-prediction of yield at low values. You see, and the boosting model seems more efficient in terms of correcting that type of bias. This is what we upload that we're going to produce in the code as well. That is called the multi-way importance plot, where we measure the importance of the variables. So basically, the most upper right that a variable is the most important. So this is following random forest, right? And here you may see AS is all September and JJ is June, July. So you may see that the two is kind of, how to say, we might suspect that we have some issues with correlated variables because the temperature during August, September is highly correlated with June, July. So the random forest model, even though it's producing good outputs, probably it's not the most efficient to produce the importance assessment. Here there is a comparison of the importance following the different approaches, and we may see that that in the random forest, the first two most important variables are highly correlated to each other, while following the sea forest, we shrink most of the variables towards zero and basically isolated most of the noise, right? From the signal, we isolated noise from the signal, and we established that the most important variables were irrigation and previous crop, and then the rest were not so much important. And then following boosting, it follows a different approach, and we're not going to discuss that, but I just wanted to show you that the different models may have different outputs in terms of prediction ability, but also in terms of the prediction performance. So it's always good to test a couple of them and see if we have some trend that is clear or not. So basically, the main conclusion is that the boosting seems to be the most efficient tree-based model to produce ensembles, right? Then we also have the random forests that are pretty good to produce prediction, but sometimes they cannot be reliable to produce an output related to the importance of the value. So we need to take care about that. In that case, I would recommend to use the sea forest instead of the random forest. So now I will jump to the example in the code. I don't know if you were able to download the files that I shared. I shared the code and two CSV files. Let me.
Hey, Adrian.
Okay.
Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Hey, this is Leo. I just wanted to say something quickly here. Yes. When I was running your first chunk for installing the packages, I noticed that the console got stuck, and I realized that if you actually open the console, it's going to ask you, I think it asks if you want to install from GitHub or something. You just have to push Y on your keyboard to let it go through.
Yeah.
So if anybody gets stuck running that first chunk, you just got to do that. I don't know if you want to show that perhaps so people know what to do if they run into that issue.
Yeah. Sometimes if we have a package that is not installed, we may see here the problems that I have them all installed. Let me. Let me go to one of the packages and yeah, sometimes it happens. Do you see my screen now? Yeah.
Yes, I see your RStudio window.
Yeah. Okay. Okay. So basically when we use the library easy packages, every time we run this line using the packages function, if we don't have the package installed, we are going to see a message in the console that where we have to press I if we want to install the package. In this case, I won't be able to show because I already have the package installed. I don't know any habits. Any one of you having issues with this? No, anybody? So I would assume that we don't have any issues, and we will keep running. And then, of course, like yesterday, you will have the video to. To follow the code later on. So basically we are going to read the same data set than yesterday, right? That is the same fake data set. So let me run here the whole chunk. So basically we have a total of 41 variables. I'm not constraining the data set like Leo did yesterday, because in purpose, I want to show you the problem when we have correlated variables with random forest. So we are going to include all the variables. So we're and the first three variables that will be the categorical predictors are also included into the model, right? So here in purpose, you may have issues with random forests or with the trees. If the variables are characters, because the model prefers or the algorithm prefers you to use a factor instead of a character. So this function of mutate if, it could be quite useful, and I use it just in case. So this, it will mutate if the variable is a character, it will mutate it as a factor. So let me show you an example. So we may see here that till fungicide and Enoch, they are the three of them are characters. In this case, if we just run this and we create another data set that is called data set. Is the one we're going to use later on. We just mutated them. And then now you see that it's recognizing that tillage or till is a vector with factor that has two levels. Fungicide, it has a factor with three levels, and inoculation is a factor with two levels as well. So that is a recommendation that I have for avoiding issues later. One important thing that we need to take care about is also about setting a seed. A seed is very important. We are going to run a cross-validation when we split our data, because every time we are going to create a split, many times we would like to have the exactly the same split. So if we set a seed number one, we will have the same observations, for example, here. I'm creating in purpose two training and testing sets, taking 50 and 50 or 85 and 15% of the data using the seed number one. So every time I run the code, I will produce exactly the same training and testing sets. Otherwise, if you don't set that seed, every time you run, you will get different results. So I recommend also to use to set a seed and choose a number of your preference. So basically here, the idea is to show you how the regression trees are sensitive to the training sets. And here we are going to produce two, if I split 50 and 50 and 85 and 15%. So with this line, we're going to select the training and testing for the 50 and the training and testing for 15. Let's see an example. So for the testing subset, you will see that we have 300 observations, right? We're keeping the same number of columns, but just half of the data. And in the case of the testing related to 85%, we only have 90, right? That is the 15 remaining using in the testing as a testing set. Okay. Okay, now if you install the package that is our part, so you will need here, you will need a package that is installed in the first chunk. You will find this package is the one we need for this chunk. This is the R part to produce the classical regression trees. And we're going to produce two. The first one is the R part, using the training with 50% of the data, okay? So, and here we have we need to define the function is R part, And then here we need to define the formula. We just define the formula as grain yield, which is our first variable, as a function of all the rest. We tell the model that it's all the rest with the dot symbol, okay? We just use a dot, and that means that we use the rest of the variables as predictors, okay? The method, if we are going to use a regression in case of a continuous variable, we need to say that it's an ova, okay? Because we're going to fit a regression tree. The data, we need to use the data train, the train 50, right? So we're going to train our tree with 50% of the data, okay? And then we have a control that is basically how we prune the tree. Okay, and the control we need to define our part control, which is the pruning. And here we have the parameter that I was talking about during the presentation, which is the complexity parameter. In this case, 0, 0, 1, we put a threshold that we are not interested in any variable that is not explaining at least 1% of the error. We may use something even smaller if you want. Okay, let's use 0, 0, 1%. And here is the most interesting option that I find using the RPAR package, that is the XVAL. XVAL is basically performing a cross-validation inside of our training set. So basically we're producing the nested cross-validation that I was telling you a while ago, okay? So this function is pretty useful and is already included with the function. It's pretty easy to use. We don't have to create any division of our data set. And then we might also define a maximal depth, right? A maximal depth means the number of the branches that we want in our tree. So let's say if we don't have an extremely complex model, we may use 20 as the maximum number of branches. We also have one option that is the minimal split, that it means, okay, if we want to divide a new the data in two portions, that portion that we are going to divide with a split, it shouldn't be less than, let's say here, 100 observations, okay? So that will depend on the size of your data set, okay? And we may put any restriction, I'm just leaving it there, just in case if we wanna tune the model using that. And we also have one concept that is called min bucket. Min bucket means the minimum number of observations that we want a new branch or we have, okay? A new branch on the terminal node, and I will show you that later. So basically, we don't want to finish our model with a class, with a final classification with less than 10 observations to allow to have some error on that, right? So let's run this training. So we're running for the train 50. And we are also going to use the same for the training with 85% of the data, okay? So let's call it our part. Training 85%. Okay, and then if we are not interested in prediction, but only on interpretation of our data set, we may use the whole data set. That is also possible. And I like this option as well as running the trees for prediction, because they are very intuitive and sometimes they may be very easy to show to convey a message. So this is also an option, right? So with this, the models are not final. We are just using the cross-validation to find the best value of the CP parameter, okay? So later we have, for that, we have the option that is the function plot CP, Okay, that is, it comes with the R part package. And here we are going to plot the three. Okay. So basically here we have the results. This is the cross, the remaining error, right? The error of these bars, each dot is the average of the 10 folds that we use as a cross validation, and the error is how is the variability over those 10 folds or 10 subgroups of the data. So basically here the model is drawing us a line here at AS085. So it's telling us that the best model, it has a CP value. Okay, if you follow here, it has a CP value that is about 0.7 or something like that. Okay. However, if we go to the this is the first is the tree using 50% of the data to train the tree, the model. The second option is using 85% of the data. Okay. And for that, let's see the difference. In the first model, we have an optimal value of 0.07 as CP, but for having an error of 0.85, a relative error of 85%, as compared to the whole error, right? To the null model. But if we move to using 85% of the data, will we be able to reduce that to 0.6, right? So we are explaining more or less 40%, or we have an R square of about 40%, okay? But the complexity parameter here is different. If you see, it should be something about 0.3 or 0.2, 0.02, sorry. Moreover, if we use the whole data set, the entire data set, it tells us that the best model, it should be pretty similar to the results that we're obtaining using 85% of the data. So that's the main problem using the trees, that if we split our data set, depending on how many folds we divide or how is this, the 50-50 or 85-50, the results may be quite different. And we may see the results here. Let's print the first result, and this is the outcome. And here we have the structure of the tree, right? So we have 15 branches of the model, and the first branch is explaining 15% of the data. The second branch is applying 10%, the following 7%, 5%, 4%, 3, 2, 1, and then we have here, 2%, 1, and here we have a threshold, right? But this model showed us that the best split, but that the best CP was about 0.3. Let me see again. Yeah, something 0.07. Okay, so with this result, we may go to the we may update. I just leave it for the. So we may update the model with 50%. Right, so we use the function prune, right? So we don't need to write the whole model again. So we use the same result, but we use a CP of 0.07, right? And here we will have the tree of using the 50% prune. So let's. Here we may see the plot. So this is if we prune the tree, right? The best structure of the tree will be only including two variables, inoculation and soil organic matter, using 50% of the data, right? So now let's do the same, but using the whole data set. So let's go to the plot CP of the whole data set, and then let's find the best, the best value. Okay, let's say that it was 0.02, 0.03, something like that. Using, and then we will produce a tree. So you see that we are going to have a tree that is a little more complex. Ah, no, sorry. Here I made a mistake. That's why. Oh, sorry. So let's compare. Let's compare the two trees. So this is a tree using 50% of the data. Let's see that now the importance, the most important variable is solo organic matter, but at level of 1.1. And then we have inoculation, and then we have temperature during pre-planting. However, if you use the whole data set, the results may be completely different of the tree. You see that? You follow? We have inoculation as the most important variable, then solo organic matter, but the threshold seems to be about 3%. And then we have BPD, also solo organic matter as well. So what I'm trying to show here is that it's the main problem of the regression trees, that they are pretty sensitive to the training set. Okay, and that's why for machine learning purposes, many times they are not preferred. So many times we may follow other approaches like using ensembles that they are less that they have less variance. Okay, and then let's see again the similarities between here will be 0.3 again, similar to the whole. So let's see the similarities between using 85%. And here we also have another result. Look at this. So if we prune the tree of using 85% of the data, we still have difference as compared to the using 50% or using the whole data set. So that's the main problem, because here, how do you decide which tree to use, right? How much of the data to use? We don't have such a clue with this. So let's see if we want to plot the different trees, okay? And here we will plot the prune trees. So I want to show you a little bit how to tune the plots, right? So this is the normal output, the default output. But we can tune the layout, and it will be pretty easy. Here I'm leaving you the code to define a gradient of colors, going to red if the yield is low, to green if the yield is high. Then we define different features relating to what variables we want to show, if we want to show the numbers of observation on each of the branches, the size of the letters and the fonts. So let's see the first. You see that we have an output that is a little more appealing, right? So I like this tree much more than the previous one. So then you can still fine tune this and save as a PNG file or JPG, whatever. But basically it's not difficult to tune. It's not difficult to tune. Here it's not. You see, this is a problem when the tree is not pruned. That it will be pretty complex to explain. So we may use the prune. It will be prune by using 85, sorry. And here we have a tree that is prune. Okay. And we also can, we may do the same with the, using the whole data set. So in my case, I like to use the trees, but mainly using the whole data set for interpretation purposes, not for prediction. I want to show how was the behavior following different different variables, but it won't be useful for prediction, okay? And now we also have the option of running the seed trees, the conditional trees. The function it belongs to the party kit. So the library that we need here is the party kit. Sorry. The library that you will need here is the party kit. Okay. Is this one. And then it follows a similar but not exactly the same statements. We have the formula that is the same. We define grain yield as a function of everything else. Then we define where is the data. So in this case, it will be the training with 50%. Then we have the control of the trees. So basically, this is the pruning, right? This is to prune the trees. And for pruning the trees, the main criteria we use is the alpha. So instead of defining the minimum limit of percentage of the error to be explained, we define a significance threshold, okay? So if the division that we are producing is not, it doesn't have a p-value less than 5%, the split won't be produced, okay? So it's another different criteria to prune the trees. And here we may still use the same, here you may see that the max depth and the min bucket, they are the same options as compared to our part, okay? And here I'm just leaving you the other options where we can use different type of tests, including Monte Carlo and test type, but I don't recommend to explore too much this because I think that it doesn't work too much. The only thing that I recommend is to use the quadratic split stat instead of the maximal, because this defines a threshold as a function and not as a maximum. I want to explain that because it will be too difficult, but just keep using the quadratic approach. That is more efficient than using maximum. That is a normal one, okay? So here we just run the tree for 85% of the data, for 50% of the data, 85% of the data. And we also use that for using the whole data set. And then the problem that I found with this is that the output is pretty, look at the output. I mean, you see this, but it's much difficult to follow, right? So even though it has some advantages on the splitting criteria and the statistical significance and so on, I find this not intuitive. It's not easy to read, and it's very big, and I would prefer much to have a table or something like that. So basically, I don't like too much this. So let's compare the results. So here we are plotting, this is the tree, right? But the counterpart of this package is that it doesn't include the cross-validation option. So we don't know where to stop the pruning, right? We don't know where to stop. So we may tune the tree. So let's see this size. So we may re-parameterize the alpha and then the maximal depth, and then we may reduce to 5. So if we don't have more than 5 divisions. So we updated that and then we plot. Wait, what happened? Sorry, I wasn't expecting it. I use min max depth. It shouldn't be so 50%. 50%. too big. I wasn't expecting it. But I mean, we already reduced the model as compared to the previous one. I was expecting it to be small. So basically, the maximal the maximal depth is 5. So we have the first division, 2, 3, 4, and 5. Okay, so that's how you divide the you stop the branching of the tree. Okay, so you stop the partitioning at this level. So you have 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. So that is the maximal depth. At the same time, we are also reducing the we are also putting a constraint. Remember that the mean bucket, that we don't have a terminal node, that a terminal node is how many observations we have for each of the box plot here, okay? So we don't want to have less than 10 observations, okay? To produce a robust mean or something of that group, okay? That is very important to follow. Normally, I won't recommend less than 5 observations, depending on the size of your data set. But less than 5 observations, you cannot have a robust estimation of the mean of that group and the error as well to compare against other groups. Okay. So here you may see that the most important variable is inoculation. Okay, using 50% of the data with the C3, while using the R part. Let's go to the R part. If we use to the R part and we plot the first, let's compare 50%. Okay. We have soil organic matter as the first variable, then inoculation, and then BPD in pre-planting period. But then if we use the C3, we have inoculation as the most important. Then we have soil organic matter, right? And then we have many other splits. So basically we have another structure of the tree based on the splitting criteria, okay? And that will be also reflected on the, if we use the whole data set. You see, it will be too complex, but then if we prune and when we reduce also to 5, let's see if we want the tree for interpretation. You see, we reduce as well, but with this tree, the trend I see is that it's less dependent to the data set we are using to the training set. Okay, so at least this model it presents a trade-off that is less dangerous as compared to our part. Regarding to which data set we use for training the model. Okay. Okay, here we have the two main options to run the trees. And then a very important part is how the models are predicting unseen observations, right? So if we follow the simple criteria of splitting in 50 and 50, okay. So we may use the predict function of R part, okay? And then we have the R part, the model, and this is the new data that we use. Sorry that I didn't define that. So basically here we are predicting the data for the 50% that it wasn't unseen for the testing data, okay? And then we may see what is the error in terms of R square, for example. So it's 30% if we use 50% of the data, okay? With this will be with C3. And then if we use 85% of the data, we see that we increase the explanation of the model in about 10%. Now we are able to explain 41% of the data. The problem with this is that if we are using the whole data set, we don't have a testing portion to check how was the prediction, okay? Another interesting option that I see here is that the R part, it includes the possibility of obtaining the nodes. So if you follow the this plot, for example, we may create four clusters, right, based on different combination of variables. And these clusters are different in terms of yield, right? But they are following certain combination of variables. So we may use these clusters to compare groups with after. So let's see the comparison that I put here. Sorry. So if you go to here, you might create the nodes, and it's pretty easy if you just read the the model, that it will be our part in this case using all the observations. You just need to put the dollar sign, and then we just put where, and this function is going to tell to which terminal node the observation belongs. Okay, to so basically we obtain the node, and then if we merge the data sets, we may run an ANOVA or similar. Okay. And then we see that we may run an ANOVA of these different four groups, and we see that the difference are statistical, okay? So we have a p-value that is less than 0.5, and with an R-square of 0.45, right? So these trees, the model of R-parties will be also useful to obtain these different subpopulations of our data set. So that is a good site that I see also from our part. Now I would like to go to the Li-Wanau cross-validation. Okay. In this case, if we are using the whole data set to run our tree, I remember that the problem I mentioned is that we don't have a testing portion of our data set to check how is the prediction. But we may still use an option that is the Li-Wanau cross-validation. So in this case, we have 600 observations. So basically, we're going to run 600 trees, right? Setting aside one observation at a time. So we're going to train the model with 599 observations, and we're going to test the model against the remaining observation. And we're going to do that n times, okay? And that's what we do here with our parts, Li-Wanau cross-validation. I'm not going to run this now. You may run it in your computer, but it will take a while. So I already have the data, stored on my computer. So I just going to produce a plot to show you how the observations are. Oh, I don't have it. I don't have it. Come on, let's see. Oh, I will need to do it anyway. Okay, let's wait a minute. So basically here we are going to write the 600 trees. And probably while we are waiting, I can answer any question that you may have. I know that is a lot of content and material. So if you have any question. Sorry, Leo, I don't hear. What? Let me stop the sharing. I think I have issues with the mic.
No, evidently you're just such a great teacher that that nobody has questions at the moment, and there's no in the
okay.
questions in the chat.
Okay. No, I was checking that. I was in my headphone or something. Okay. Let me go again to the call.
So, Adrian, this is Andre. Can I have a question? Andre.
Yeah.
I mean, so far, great content. I mean, really nice. A lot of information. Really, really important concepts that you're explaining. And Adrian, my question is regarding the hyperparameters of the trees. How do you find a sweet spot between depth and the other nodes numbers? And I mean, how do you find a way to trim the tree in a way that it is statistically right? And I mean, you're not kind of overfitting or overworking the algorithms to find the result that you want. So how to have this, you know, parsimonious training process in the tree?
Yeah, in that regards, Andrea will say that the most suitable model will be the C tree, right? Because it allows us to include a statistical criteria that as compared to the R part. We define a rule, right? That is kind of, how to say, it's more fair, if you want, that just using the size of the error that we are reducing, because that is very dependent on the training set. So I would say that the most robust models for trees, they are going to be obtained using the C tree function, but it will require to play a little before with R part to get trained with and getting familiar with the trees, and then also having patience, because sometimes the C trees may run much slower, right? So basically, I mean, if you want a more robust tree, I will follow the C tree function, and that is what, for example, Leo and Mario did in a paper that they published with canola analysis with winter survival. Basically, I will try to use that, and that is a discussion that is in literature. If we have to tune the alpha as a parameter, or if we just include it as a threshold, right? Because if we include it as a parameter, we may have the risk that the alpha, it could be the optimum alpha, it could be too low, right? Because it will improve the prediction, but it will be just overfitting the model, right? So instead, if we use as a threshold criterion, we said that, okay, if it's not significant or less than 5%, we are not going to produce a new branch. So following that criteria is a much robust decision, I would say.
Nice. Thanks, Adrian. And a second question, if I may, yeah. For the C-tree method, would have a rule of thumb of the size of the data set? I mean, if you have a fairly small data set, wouldn't be suitable to try to run the C-tree? Would have any thoughts regarding the size of the data set?
Yeah, I mean, the problem with the size of the data set, it will also depend if it's balanced or not, in terms of the range of the values of our predictor. That could be a constraint, because sometimes we are doing a review and we have let's say 100 observations, and probably 50 of those 100 will be all concentrated in one or two locations, right? So it will be very dependent on the structure of the data set, not only on the size. Because even if you have a data set of, 1,000 or 2,000 or more observations, if you have observations that they are very close to each other, you are likely also to have some issues with the prediction power. So as long as the data set becomes smaller, I will be more biased towards using the tree for interpretation and not for prediction. So I will decide, okay, I will be completely biased. I will overfit my tree, but I will explain the behavior on these locations pretty well. Mm-hmm. Okay. But we don't have the prediction side.
Yeah.
But still, it will be useful to interpret the results.
Mm-hmm. Great. Great. Thanks, Adrian.
Okay. So now, what I wanted to show here is how the trees.
Andrea, you may have to share your screen again.
Ah, yes. Sorry. I just went. Yes. Sorry. Okay, now?
Perfect.
Yeah, okay. So we just ran the six-handed trees here, and then we are going to obtain here the predictions for each of the folds that we created. We may try to understand this later, but here basically with this minus X, we are removing one observation at a time. So this is a loop using the map function to remove one observation at a time. So basically we're creating 600 sub data sets, removing one observation at a time. So here we are going to add to the data set the target values of the observations to come against. Finally, we'll produce a plot. So this is the plot of the tree. Ugly, right? So that is the usual outcome of the trees. That you have kind of straight lines, I mean, in terms of prediction, because they are the classes. So even though we are removing one observation at a time, the trees are kind of similar, so they are producing similar classes. That's why we see the similar straight lines where the observations are concentrated, okay? And then here we produce a plot, and now we are going to produce different indicators related to the root mean square error, which is 800 kilos. The 12 here is the bias, so it's pretty low. Is the bias is only 12 kilos, and the bias means the difference between the means of the variables. So the mean of the predicted is very similar to the mean of the observation. So that's why we used to get using the leave one out, that the predictions or the estimation of the error is very has a low bias. And here I just wanted to show you an example using the relative root mean square error using a package that is this one, FGMUtils, but it's producing a pretty weird value. So basically, the relative root mean square error, it estimates the how much of the error represents as compared to the mean of the observations. Okay, so if we estimate this 800 kilos of a mean of I don't know the mean of the predictions, but it doesn't seem to be 0.08, so it's pretty low. So sometimes I will advice, if you are able to define the metrics by hand. So in this case, I'm just leaving you the formula of the relative root mean square error, which is basically here the root mean square error divided the mean of the observation. Okay. So this is a manual formula, and then if we estimate that, You see, it's 20%. So those 800 kilos of room in Escolero represents a relative error of 20%. So here you have some code to address, to assess the performance of the model. And similarly, you can also do the same with the Libano for the C-trees. So it's exactly the same code. Just here, try to replace it with the best parameters you find. If you want the same structure of the trees, just use the best that you consider optimal, and then you can do exactly the same. Similarly, one option that it could be of interest, mainly in agronomy, is to use the leaf with one group out of a time. So let's say that we have ear as a variable, and we have some ears that they are pretty different to the rest. So we might be interested on how a model could predict that ear using the rest of the ear as an input, okay? So in our case, we don't have the ear as a variable in our data set. So we may create that variable artificially. So here I'm just assigning an integer with a floor function of runif, and we just assign a random number between 2012 and 2020, okay? So if we create that, here we do the same, but instead of running 600 trees, we'll run 10 trees or 11, I mean, including 2010 to 2020, okay? So we are going to run 11 trees here. Okay, so let's see. Sorry. Here we are just defining the, let me show you. We are just defining, okay, the faults. So we have a training and testing, putting aside the 2020 first, okay? So this data set has the 2010 as a testing data set. And then we have all the years, okay? So let's check that it's working, okay? So here we should have, you see that is all 2010. So this is the year that we are using to test the prediction of the model, okay? So here we just defining the training and the data sets depending on the year. So we are using the group, Libano group validation, okay? So let's run here we just create a function. You may explore that later, but here we are just getting the observations, the predictions with map functions, the root mean square error and the R squared, okay? So this function, it will run this for the different faults that we are running. So here we just call the RPAR models using the logo CV, which are the data sets nested, right? Following this structure. And then we run the model. So let's see. We run the 10 trees for the RPAR, and then we also run the 10 trees for the C-tree. Okay. And then we run the metrics part. And finally, we will create the plots to see how the models are predicting, okay? So let's see. This is the performance of the R part. We are putting all together the 10 years, right? Or the 10 folds. But this is how the R part is predicting our observation, right? And this is how the C-tree is predicting. You may see that the structure of the tree, right? Or the prediction is different, and that is being reflected here, you see? So if you ask me, it's pretty obvious that the C-tree in the blue, right? Using the blue is predicting much better than the R part, okay? Because the structure of the trees is different. And then we may also have the different room mean square error for the different years. So we may identify if one year has especially high or low error. For example, I don't know, we have one year that is, it has 30% of R squared, and we have another that it has 60 or 62. So we may go specifically to those years and check if something, if they have something in particular. In this case, we just assign a random year, right? So we are not expecting any effect, but in your own data sets, you may have that effect, and it will be interesting to explore. Okay. So here we have the C tree and compare with this is the R bar as compared to the C tree performance. Okay. Here I just left this empty. We don't need that. So basically, now we are going to jump very quick to random forest. And we are going to do the same. So we are going to produce the random forest. So this is the general formula. Okay, we have the random forest, the formula, which is grain yield as a function of everything else, similar to the R bar function. We use the data. In this case, we're using the training data, right? We're using the years, right? We're using the same, leaving 1 year out at a time. And then we use the number of trees and the M try as the hyperparameters. So here, at the bottom of the code, you may see that we have hyperparameters, and we have different nested growth validation and the how is the tuning, right? So I'm leaving you the code there. We are not going to run that because it could be pretty heavy. But the idea is that you will optimize your trees or your forest, right? And you will create a grid with different combinations of the entry. So let's see that you have, you want to try a forest with 200 trees, 400, 600, 800, whatever, right? And then you want to try with selecting six random variables at a time, 8, 10, 15. It depends. And then this will depend on the number of groups you have. So in our case, we have, I think that there are 10 or 11, depending on the year. So, but you may check this part of the code later, by your own. And if you have any questions, just let me know. But basically here, what I'm going to show you is, so we have the random forest function. We already supposed to have the optimum level of trees, the number of trees, and the optimum number of random variables to select the best splits. And then we will run the trees for this. And then we are going to obtain the same than before. You see that it's taking a while because we are running all the trees. And then we'll produce the plots related to prediction. So what I wanted to show you here is, let's see how the prediction is much more smooth as compared to the trees, right? So if we go to the trees and the predictions, let's see. This is the R part, right? And the random forest is using exactly this, the R part, these trees, but using the bootstrap samples is able to create this quality of predictions. It's much, much better, even though if we have some tails or whatever, right? But this approach is able to read much more complex patterns that the data may have that we cannot read with a single tree, right? So basically what is doing the model is doing bootstrap samples, is running one tree for each of those resampling, and then it averages all the predictions to get a much more smooth, and we don't have those, strain lines of prediction. So this is the output that we may see. And in different colors, we have the years. So we may use at the top And here in different colors, you may plot the different ears to see if we have any particular ear. For example, if we have this tail, we may have that one of the ears is particularly located there, or one location or whatever. You can do the group instead of ear, you can use state or county or whatever. So we may do exactly the same for the sea forest. And we're using a similar structure and just reducing a couple the number of trees because this model takes a while. In this function, what I wanted to show is that instead of using alpha, right, we use mean criteria, right? So we may define alpha or the mean criterion. So the mean criterion, it will be the opposite. It will be 0.95. So here it was a mistake, sorry. Or let's see. Ah, no, you see, it was mean criterion. Sorry, mean criterion. So this is a little bit tricky because even though it uses the same, we need to use the opposite. So this is the 95% is the confidence level, right? When we use the C3 as a tree level, we need to use alpha and it will be 5%. But in the opposite, if we go to the forest, we need to use this criterion. What we are controlling here, we are pruning the trees, right? So here we define the forest. Here we are defining the structure of the forest, but with this, we are pruning the trees with the alpha. But the tricky side is that it calls the mean criterion. So let's see again and compare. So this is the prediction of the sea forest, and this is the prediction of the random forest. So you may see that the sea forest is slightly better, right? Sometimes they are the same. If you ask me, I mean, this data set, it has a little more variance because the points are more spread. But if you compare this, it has less variance, but it has a bias here with this tail. So those are the trade-offs that we may see with the different models. So we may decide to use this model or this other. Both, I think that they are much better for prediction purposes as compared to run a single tree, right? Or a couple of trees to create predictions. But basically the most important part of the code here is here. Is defining the forest. That is not difficult at all, okay? So now we're going to jump to the importance, okay? And for the importance, we are going to need these packages. The random forest explainer, right? You need to install this. And we have another one that is the permutation importance. And let me see if I have. But yeah, I already have those. So I don't need to run this because the permutation importance will be slow to run. Okay, let me load these packages. We have two options to measure the importance. One option, right? It could be using the whole data set. We have all our training done. So we already optimized all the parameters. So now we have the structure of the tree defined, 600 trees and 8 as the M try number. And then we may define how is the importance, right? On the whole data set. That is one of the approaches that is valid. So if we run this, we run the final random forest, which was already optimized over the training sets. And then we have an importance we may plot an importance plot that is a classical output that we may get using random forest. The increase in the mean square error and the no purity increase. Basically, the most important is this one, is the increase in the mean square error. It's the most followed criteria for a regression problem, right? But I wanted to show you that we can combine these two in another plot that is much more appealing, I would say. So this plot belongs to the random forest explainer. So let me random forest explainer. And here we have the plot multi-way importance. That is the one that we define below, you see? So basically, we just call the model that we defined before, define a random forest that is already run. We define which is the measure that we're putting on the X axis and on the Y axis. And then we also define the number of labels. And the number of labels is the name of the most important variable. So let's say that we're using 10 or let's say 5, right? So we may produce a plot here. It may take a while because it will run the importance. For each of the, let's wait a little.
Hey, Adrian, I just want to take this opportunity to bring your attention to the time. We're at 5:59 right now, so if we can.
Yeah, we're going to wrap up.
Yeah, we're going to need to.
It's the last part of the call.
All right, thank you.
I just wanted to show, how to run this. And be patient because it used to take a while. But. So let's keep talking about the second option. So the second option, considering that we have the different faults that we may have different groups or whatever, let's say that we have 10 different years, which were the groups that we defined before. So we may run the importance for each of the 10, and then instead of having a single number of importance, we will have 10 difference or 20 or 5 or whatever, depending on the number of the groups we have. So I think that is much more reliable to show that, how the importance could vary depending on the training set, okay? So this is a plot of the importance. Right, this is a multi-way. So here we have the no impurity increase and the mean square error increase. So basically the most upper right that the variable is, the most important it is. So we have inoculation, soil organic matter, temperature, radiation, and so on. So these are the top five, right? And then the rest, you see that they are all together, but the most important two seem to be inoculation and soil organic matter. Similarly, instead of estimating one single, we might estimate the importance for the 10 groups that we have, or 20 or whatever. So instead of having one single value here, we have the mean square error increase using the 10 folds. So we have a variability on that as well. So inoculation and soil organic matter seems to be the most important, but we may also be able to show the how is the variability on that expected importance, right? And then we may also do exactly the same for the conditional trees. I will just show you the final outcome here. To show you the difference, you see that it seems that the variable, the importance is much more depending on which year we are using. But you may see here that fungicide came up as one of the important variables. So this model seems that it removes some noise from signal because there were some variables that they may have much more potential splits. But fungicide over all the trees across the forest seems to be very important for the sea tree for the sea forest model. So you may see here that the structure of the forest is quite different comparing random forests and sea forests. So that's more or less what I had. Then I'm just leaving you the code for running the nested crop validation, creating outer and inner folds. I'm just creating small ones with 5 and 3 outer and inner. So you may run this, and if you have any questions, you just let me know. But basically here you are testing different combinations of the hyperparameters to find the best ones with the trade-off between bias and variance and bias. So here you have all the functions that you need to do that. And I hope that it may be useful for your models and your projects. So I think that we are okay with the time. I mean, it's just 4 minutes, and now I'm open for any questions you may have.
Yes, so go ahead and take this time if you want to unmute and ask a question, or you can also put them in the chat.
Adria, this is Andre again. So let me, this is Andre again.
You want to see the code?
Can you hear me okay, Adrian?
Yes.
Okay, so this is Andre again. Regarding this last section, after option 2, the perm imp asked if it should run a new random forest again for having embed information. So I didn't see it happen in your code.
Sorry, what part? Could you repeat?
In the option
I go to that. Here.
Yeah, the option 2, line 555, major importance.
Yeah, yes.
In this particular section, the perm imp package asked if a new random forest should be refit.
I don't know what to say. I'm gonna get that.
Maybe it's just my code is having some.
Yeah, it could be this package that is not or some dependence of this package that is permutation important. So I try to use the same code because it's useful for both for random forest and C forest. But basically so here we're using this package to estimate importance. Because in the case of the sea forest later, if you see here the conditional true, I haven't explained this, but this is one of the main features of the sea forest, that if you want to estimate the importance of the variables, you may follow this approach because it will correct if you have collinearity, right? So it will, a random forest has an issue that it will overestimate the importance of correlated variables, and that is related to the structure of the models, because random forests use bootstrapping, and imagine that even though if you are using random variables, imagine that you have temperature during July and temperature during August, right? And then the model in the bootstrap, if one of the M tries, one of the 6 variables that you choose, if one has temperature during July and another one has temperature during August, it will choose one or other because they are highly correlated, right? In the case of random forest, you cannot correct that. But in the case of the sea forest, it estimates a conditional importance depending on the correlation on the value. So let's say that you have these two temperatures, July and August, and then the model will estimate the importance for both, but depending if they are correlated or not. Let's say that temperature of July is more correlated, strongly correlated to the response variable, it will give more weight to that variable. And then if temperature of July is correlated with another one that is already explaining variance of the response, it will shrink the importance of that, right, to zero, because you are already explaining that part of the variance with other variable. It's a complex model and it takes a while to run, but I think that it's a safeguard that we should use when we have a data set with correlated variables. Oh.
Hey, Adrian.
Yeah.
This is Leo. Just wanted to thank you for the presentation and for putting together. I mean, all this code is really complex, and I'm sure it took you a lot of time to prepare this. So thanks for your effort on this. And I have a question / comment. Yeah. Regarding what Andre asked earlier about hyperparameter tuning.
Yeah.
And I think that, I mean, looking at your code, I think that what you do, which is also what I've been doing, is to use a regular grid, which is basically you choose some hyperparameters and then select some levels for each one of them, get all the combinations possible, and then run all those models with different folds, and then choose the best combination that optimizes some type of metric, right?
Yes, exactly.
And I just wanted to bring up this, that so I ran into the tidy models family of packages in R, and it's really, really nice that they have a few different functions that are just for hyperparameter tuning.
Mm-hmm.
And it's nice because like you can start with a regular grid, but it doesn't even have to have too many levels of the hyperparameters. But then after you run that first grid, that grid search on the regular grid, you can give those results to another function. So it could be like a Bayesian approach, or it could be, they call simulated annealing, or even racing. I mean, there are some different approaches kind of like build upon just a regular grid that really then I think it's the next level, at least to my personal workflow, of finding the best combinations of hyperparameters, you know, other than just using regular grid. So have you had a chance to explore any of those more refined?
There are two packages that I know that they do that besides the tidy environment, which are the caret or caret, I don't know how to pronounce that, caret, the caret that already includes many models of machine learning inside, and you have this option of exploring, and also the R sample also have some options related to that, mixing bootstrapping with cross-validation I've seen, but I haven't explored yet those approaches that, as you correctly say, that are more towards Bayesian approaches for optimization of the parameters. But it will be very interesting to explore. I would say that, I mean, all the models and options that we have around, they are offering new options every month or almost every week. So that is impressive because, I mean, this code is about 6 months ago, I don't know, seven. And now I'm getting old fashioned. old fashioned. But it's the way it is, right? So I will encourage you guys to explore options, and because they are, because every time you think that it may be easier, you have a complicated step. But yeah, in this case, I just use the regular grid because it was much more intuitive to me to follow what I was, what I'm doing, right? But in the, I mean, as long as you are getting practice, right, using the basics of the grids and that stuff, is pretty, I mean, advisable to do one, to make one step further and explore this more complex and probably more robust options for optimizing the parameters.
Yeah, awesome. Yeah, and just a fun fact, I guess. So Tidy Models is a family of packages. So our sample is one of those packages inside Tidy Models.
Yes.
And I'm not sure if Tidy Models itself or perhaps some packages inside Tidy Models. The author of that is Max Kuhn, which is actually the author of Carrot Package. So I think our studio either hired him or just partnered to bring in the concepts of Carrot Package into Tidy Models. So that's I thought was an interesting turn of events.
Yeah. And sometimes that we find is, for example, this sea forest, they may be pretty, they are pretty interesting, but still the algorithm is not quite efficient in terms of the computation. So in that sense, we may have another type of codes, such as the boosting, for example, that they are much more efficient for getting the prediction because of the parallel computing that they do, I mean, inside of the function that we don't know. I mean, I don't know how it works, but I mean, as I told you, we are getting new options and new algorithms every time. And sometimes an algorithm that it may be the state of the art, it may be pretty heavy to run. And sometimes you cannot run in your own computer. Or you have some types of cross-validations that they are impossible to run. So that is the main disadvantage, I would say, that the C4s have. So they are better in terms of the importance and so on, but they are much less efficient as compared to random forests, for example. So that's the main trade-off that you may find.
All right. We could maybe do one more question if someone had a burning question to ask. Otherwise, we will try to wrap up.
Okay.
All right, seeing none. Thank you very much, Adrian, for your presentation today. This was great.